is Mensa, and this is my family. I am the matriarch, their leader, and we have been through hell to get here. We faced many dangers along the way, from dehydration and crocodile-infested waters, to an army of lion prides specialized in hunting elephants. But we found paradise. Our ancient feeding grounds in the flooded swamp. Some of us never made it through, while others were lucky to survive. My son Shuma will never be the same again. He didn't always look like this. To tell that story, we must start at the very beginning, over 100 miles east, back at our home, where the adventure began. This is our home, Chobe National Park. A lush and extensive marshland in the northeast of Botswana in southern Africa. I was born here, just like my mother and her mother before. I'm Mensa, named after my great-grandmother, a strong and fearless leader. In our society, the females rule, and it is up to the most experienced to lead. Now that my mother has passed, that responsibility falls on me. I'm not just the matriarch. I'm also a mother. My youngest daughter, Ella, is nearly 4. And that one over there playing around in the dirt is my 6-month-old son, Chuma. Like all males, his father didn't stick around to raise him. But I'm not alone. The herd is my family. My sisters, cousins, and nieces all help protect, teach, and look out for each other and our young. We happily share our home with over 100,000 other elephants. But we are not the only ones who thrive here. Lions also patrol these lands. These ruthless predators are always on the lookout for an easy target. We must always be on guard. These lions are known to take down large prey like buffalo, and even elephants. In the last 4 years, they have killed over 70 of us, mostly young calves, including one of my sister's sons. As a mother myself, they are a constant concern. Most of the year, this marshland provides us with everything we need. But our home is already starting to transform. It's early August, and over the next few weeks, the dry season will lay waste to this landscape. Without food and water, we'll die if we stay. In times of desperation, we fall back on one plan. A long and treacherous journey to our ancient feeding grounds in the west. We must navigate an invisible map etched in elephant memory over 100 miles cross-country, through the dead forest, across the barren wastelands, and into the gates to the flooded swamp. For only 4 months each year, this swamp transforms into a flooded oasis with enough food and water to feed 1,000 herds. Many have died attempting this journey, but it is our best chance of survival. Even the entrance to these wetlands is guarded by an army of lion prides, specialized in hunting elephants. Yet it is a risk we must take. If we leave too late, the last remaining water holes hidden along the route may have already dried up, and we could die of dehydration. We face many dangers on the moon, but staying here without food and water is even more dangerous. And with less prey available, the lions will grow more desperate and their attacks will increase. Our best chance of keeping Shuma and the young ones alive is to leave our home. We have a long journey ahead. And we start at first light. But that night, the lions attacked us. The morning sun reveals the aftermath of last night's attack. It's Ella, and she's still alive. In the panic, she became separated from the herd and chased down. Now exhausted, she has no more fight left. I can smell the lions nearby. We can only keep them at bay for so long. Ella is too weak to even stand. As much as it hurts, there is nothing the herd or I can do for her now. One by one, her cousins, aunts, and extended family pay their respects. There's one more goodbye, and it's the hardest. As she eventually slips away, I leave my daughter's side for the first and last time. As we mourn our loss, the lions emerge from hiding. There is another resident who is not a fan of the lions' presence. Bravery. The hippo appears to defend my daughter's honor. Yet despite this valiant effort, the lions will be back. In the dry season, tough times lie ahead. If the lions are desperate enough to attack already, they will certainly attack again. It's no longer safe for us here, especially for young Chuma. I begin a series of deep rumbles emanating from my throat. These vibrations can emit a low-frequency sound up to 6 miles away. This is how I talk to my family. And the message is clear. It's time to go. Had we known what awaited us, we may have stayed to try our luck with the lions. The first leg of our journey to the flooded swamps is through the dry grasses and woodlands on the far outskirts of our home. This is our last chance to stock up on any available food. Our vegetarian diet offers us little nutrition. So to make up for it, we consume an extraordinary 300 pounds of food a day. And who needs hands to eat when you have a trunk? Thanks to over 40,000 muscles and tendons, along with two finger-like features at the tip, we can delicately pick up a flower or tear a tree straight out of the ground. Our trunks are our most prized possession, and we use them for everything, from smell and touch to, of course, feeding. All this relentless chewing and grinding isn't great for my teeth. So as each tooth falls out, it's replaced by the next in line. But they won't last forever. By the time my grandmother died at the great old age of 70, she used up all her teeth, 6 sets of molars. And like her, once my teeth are all gone, I won't be able to eat. For now, my teeth are fine, so I eat as much as I can. I must keep my strength up. My son, Chuma, is only 6 months old and too young to eat grass yet. He is completely reliant on me for milk and will continue to suckle until he's at least 2. My rich, nutritious milk provides him with everything he needs. But to maintain a sufficient supply, I need to eat a lot. If my milk dries out, he could die. We may eat a lot, but we're not fat. We're just big-boned. Yet despite our enormous size, we are incredibly nimble and sure-footed on all types of terrain, from soft sand and mud to rocky mountains. The trick is that we actually walk on our tiptoes. The bones in our feet are elegantly angled, with a large pad of fatty tissue under our heel. The spongy shock absorber helps cushion a body weight of up to 7 tons. Our feet have evolved for a lifetime of walking huge distances in search of food and water. And as the matriarch, it is my responsibility to guide us to the last dwindling water holes, hidden along route, often many miles apart. I rely on memory, instinct, and the faint scent of water to navigate a maze of secret pathways, scoured into the earth by thousands of elephant feet over hundreds of years. This is my invisible map to the flooded swamp. A mind map that connects waterhole to waterhole across the changing landscapes. If we deviate from the path, we may miss a crucial pit stop. And if we take too long, the waterholes may have already dried up. As we reach the far edges of our territory, I move on ahead with some elders to scout for danger. I pick up a familiar scent. We have evolved the longest nose in the world, and with it, an incredible sense of smell. As I draw air through my trunk and across the roof of my mouth, I can detect the distant scent of wet earth up to 12 miles away. Water is in reach. This could be our last chance to drink freely until we reach the flooded swamp. With so many thirsty mouths to feed, it's hard to contain our excitement. To siphon the cleanest drinking water, we delicately skim the surface, sucking up to 2 gallons of water at a time and squirting it into our mouths. An adult elephant can drink over 50 gallons of water a day. Chuma, though, isn't having much luck. He is still too young to control his trunk properly. This technique takes time, practice, and patience. Eventually, Chuma gives up and tries a more direct approach. Hydrated and refreshed, I lead the herd on to the next leg of our journey. If only we'd known. Remember this area. The skeletal trees, the eerie silence, and the unshakable feeling that you are being watched. This is the Dead Forest. From here, food and water is scarce. And once we enter, there's no turning back. We must be vigilant. Lions are known to patrol these lands. As a defensive precaution, my dominant females and I take the lead, while Chuma and the other young calves stay in the middle, and the other elders cover the flanks. A tender landscape surrounds us. With limited shade and water, the 100-degree heat is unbearable, especially for the biggest land mammals on the planet. Our skin is nearly an inch thick in places, and with no sweat glands, we are in severe risk of overheating. But luckily for us, we have two built-in cooling units. The skin at the back of our ears is incredibly thin and covered in an intricate web of blood vessels. By flapping our ears, we cool the blood and lower our body temperature by as much as 8 degrees. However, my grandmother also taught me another trick to cool down. A mud treatment. This natural suntan lotion first needs a good mix. And then apply generously to oneself and anyone nearby. This mud pack cools and protects our skin from the scorching heat and irritating parasites. Plus, it's a great chance to put your feet up and have a facial. Or perhaps a massage. As for Chuma, boys will be boys. Our jovial mood is short-lived. I suddenly pick up another familiar scent. I must distract them long enough for the rest of the herd to get a good head start. I fear for Chuma's life. These lions are desperate, and an attack is imminent. As I turn to leave, I spot more lions in the thicket. Camouflaged in this dense forest, the lions have the advantage. Our only chance is to get to open ground, where we can regroup and make a stand. The lines start to fan out in an attempt to cut us off. We finally break the tree line and spill out into a desolate plain. The lions are hesitant to follow. These are the barren wastelands. The toughest part of our journey. There is not much life here, just death. An ominous wind starts to pick up. As an enormous dust storm over 1,000 feet high races towards us. Trapped in the barren wasteland, and with the lions on our tail, we have no option but to face the storm head on. The 30-mile-per-hour winds are not my main concern. It's the blinding dust that can disorientate a herd or cover up their path. Elephants have lost their way crossing the barren wastelands, never to be seen again. For safety, I signal the others to form a long line, one elephant behind the other. All we can do now is brace ourselves. As the storm hits, the visibility drops to a few feet. In the chaos, I struggle to keep my eyes on Chuma and the right path. The dust storm rages across the landscape, blocking out the light. All my senses are numb by the brutal onslaught of sand and dust. Finally, the winds begin to subside, and as the haze clears, I catch a glimpse of the way out. Disorientated and still blinded by the sand, Chuma is shaken but safe. Not all have been so lucky. As we regroup, one youngster, Chuma's cousin, is missing. We search desperately for the young calf, but she is nowhere to be seen. My sister calls out with a rumble, so low it generates a seismic wave through the ground. If the youngster can hear it in reply, there is a chance we can still find her. But unfortunately, there is no response. Back in the wasteland, the missing calf is lost and alone. Separated in the storm, She finally manages to pick up the tracks of her mother. But disorientated and confused, she heads off in the wrong direction, back towards the lions. With one last glance out across the wasteland, my sister rejoins the herd. Water is our only chance of survival now. We can only go without water for up to 3 days, and we haven't had a drop in over two. Even my milk is starting to dry up. In desperation, I try to dig for water. Normally, we can reach water up to 3 feet down. I can smell it. It's so close. But in my weakened state, the earth is just too hard to penetrate. I must conserve my energy for Chuma. Starved and dehydrated, we struggle on. Just a few miles farther, the desolate plains finally give way to thicker woodland. And with it, the invigorating smell of water. We can't believe our eyes. These are the far edges of a flooded swamp. Water has never tasted so good. The water brings with it healing and peace, washing away the woes of our treacherous journey. While the others drink and play, I'm already planning the next move. Our journey is not over yet. We've had a drink. Now it's time to feed. Our ancient feeding grounds are hidden on the luscious wooded islands, deep in the heart of the swamps. This final leg of the journey comes with its own risks, and we cannot let our guard down for a second. Before we face the army of lion prides that guard the gates to this island paradise, we must first cross the waters, patrolled by another lethal predator, crocodile. This is the flooded swamp. The great Okavango Delta. For only 4 months each year, billions of gallons of water from the Angolan highlands spill into this dry dustpan of the Kalahari. The landscape completely transforms into a tropical oasis as the delta swells to 3 times its normal size and attracts wildlife from far and wide, including my family. To reach our sacred feeding grounds in the heart of the swamps, we must first navigate a maze of channels. Most crossings are easy for such large animals, but it's not long before we reach one of the deeper, fast-flowing channels. To cross here, we must swim. Chuma is nervous, and he has good reason. These waters are home to a deadly predator, crocodile. A crocodile is little threat to a 4-ton elephant, but a young calf is fair game. These ruthless predators have taken our young before, grabbing on to any available limb or trunk before dragging them underwater. For safety, we bunch together to form a barrier. But all this commotion draws the crocodiles closer. Chuma kicks as hard as he can to stay afloat, but he is tired and begins to struggle. He finally discovers a use for his little trunk, a snorkel. My son swims for his life. Finally, we reach the bank, and just in time. The crocodiles may have missed this opportunity, but they will be back. With Chuma finally on solid ground, we head deeper into the swamp. We soon join other herds, also making their way to the wooded islands. Our ancient feeding grounds are just up ahead. We are so close, but we are also being watched. These lions are the gatekeepers to this paradise. And like their desert cousins, they have mastered the art of taking down elephants. For the last week, they have been watching numerous exhausted herds arrive, waiting for the right target. And now they have eyes on us. We have come too far and sacrificed too much to stop now. We charge as one. The lions scatter, but only to regroup. They keep their distance. These are experienced hunters. They move around us, camouflaged by the tall grass. Their goal is to cause panic and split up the herd, separating the mothers from the calves. And their tactics work. In the confusion, I lose sight of Chuma. I can't find him. In all the noise, I hear one terrified cry. It's him. Where is he? Where is my son? In desperation, I call out, But to no avail. Our search carries on into the night. By first light, there is still no sign of him. I keep retracing my steps, looking for something, a clue as to his whereabouts. But nothing. I have to stay positive. But the longer he's alone, the less chance he has to survive. Our search takes us deeper into the swamp. As we break the tree line, we meet an incredible sight. These are the ancient feeding grounds. The luscious wooded islands of the flooded swamp. Some herds have already arrived. And over the next few weeks, more will join us in this paradise. We traveled over 100 miles to get here, and we're rewarded with a magnificent feast. We can eat to our heart's content, and more. It's a bittersweet moment. Everyone is so happy to finally be here. But there's still no sign of Juma. If only he was here to enjoy this with us. Suddenly, a rustle. The lions could easily have caught up. It's Juma. I don't know how he survived, and I don't care. He's alive, but he hasn't escaped unharmed. In the attack, the lions tore off part of his trunk and his tail. Life is going to be tough for him. But my son's strong, a survivor. He may never be able to skim water or pick up a branch, but he still looks happy to be alive. He will learn to adapt, because when he's just a teenager, he will leave my side and roam the lands as a solitary bachelor. Until then, he has his family to look out for him.